Welcome to the Public Voice Salon. We're an open dialogue on education, the arts, and social change. My name is John Braden, and my wife Claudia and I are co-producers of this show, and we are so happy today because one of our favorite guests is with us, Professor Stephen Eric Bronner, is a professor of political science at Rutgers University, one of the leading public intellectuals in our country, actually, author of a wonderful book on critical theory. He's also the head of U.S. Academics for Peace. And we're going to talk here today in his Fort Lee, New Jersey living room, a beautiful cosmopolitan setting with books behind us here. And we're going to talk here, we're going to try to go a little deeper intellectually into what's happening in the country right now as far as our election cycle with Donald Trump, the front runner for the Republican Party. And I say whether you agree with his policies or not, it's a fascinating phenomenon to watch, you know. And there's something about Trump that this theatricality. There's a lot there, you know. There's a lot one could psychoanalyze. One could go deeper into what's really going on, but it's a phenomenon, and we're going to try to dissect it and go deeper into Trumpism and also Brexit. Because that's what's going on now with the European Union, which seems to be dissolving, and England has just, you know, decided to vote itself out of the European Union. And Trump also showed up in Scotland, you know, for that, and he was celebrating that. So there is this element that Trump is channeling an anger from the working class because of the outsourcing of jobs and factories, and he's against bad trade deals, you know, the trade deals he thinks that are bad for the working class. But there's a lot more to it than that, and we're going to spend an hour with one of the leading public intellectuals in our country, and we're going to go deeper than we ordinarily see on our mainstream media today. So welcome to the show, Stephen, and you can start with Trump. What's your analysis?
Well, let me put it this way, with regard to the celebrity status and so on. An old teacher of mine once said that the dim light shines brighter in the dark. And it seems to me that this is part of the phenomenon. You know, every successful far-right or extremist movement has built off a mainstream conservatism in which the wise guys among the establishmentarian conservatives thought, oh, we can manipulate these guys. We can handle these guys. And pretty soon the tail starts wagging the dog. This was clearly the case with regard to the Tea Party and the Republican Party. The Republican Party originally thought these guys are great. The Tea Party is great in order to help bring down President Obama or make his administration fail. Pretty soon, this far-right organization was attacking the mainstream Republicans themselves, and for a good reason. What propelled the Tea Party and then Donald Trump to power was not only the incredible lack of ideas and the failed policies of the Bush administration, but also the boring nature of what they were doing. Boredom is one of the most terrible things to deal with in politics. And whatever you want to say for Donald Trump, he's certainly not boring. Whether he's unique, that's another matter, and I think that that is pushed much too much by the mainstream media. You know?
Did you want to? Well, I wanted to say that boredom, I'm so glad you brought that up, because that is a concern of mine as an educator. How do we deal with boredom, and how do we wake people up? And there's different ways of doing that, and the arts is one way. Mm-hmm. Exposure to artworks creates this kind of wide awakeness, mm-hmm. community, dialogue. And maybe it's just the fact that there's been so much deception in politics. They've been hiding what they're doing, that it just got boring, where people are catching on to the sort of neoliberalism or the mainstream conservatism that's not been good for working folks. you know, and people are starting to see through it, and they want someone that's going to actually speak to them.
You know, I don't know. I mean, you may very well be right. Mm. I'm not sure, though, that the lying is anything really new. Mm. One of our greatest senators was Senator J. William Fulbright from Arkansas. He was the most articulate critic of the Vietnam War. But he voted for the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, where basically it was claimed that Vietnamese gunboats had fired on United States vessels. And he was later on questioned about this, and he said, look, President Johnson came to me and said, we have been fired on. What am I supposed to do, call the president a liar? Even though he was. This is all, I think this is all stuff that comes after the fact. What seems to me is interesting about Trump is that he's the American version of what's become an international phenomenon, which is the rise of the rise of far-right extremism. Trump, in this regard, is not very different from Silvio Berlusconi in Italy, another media mogul, or another mogul, in that case it was the media, another person who was an outsider to politics. In fact, all of the leaders of these far-right movements claim to be outsiders. By the way, that's been a consistent matter for right-wing movements almost from their inception. It's what Mussolini and Hitler noted. The corrupt system, the rigged system. We are on the outside. We will create a new set of values for the system. We are honest, we are pure, we're saying it the way it is. Everybody, this is all the same stuff. And the media, the American media, is left and right, is so irresponsible in this regard. Because what we constantly, what they constantly feed off is the need for sensation. Sensationalism. And one of the best ways to create sensationalism is to say, we are unique. This is unique, even when it's not. If we knew a little more history and we were able to contextualize events a little better, I think we'd be able to deal with them a little better.
As far as his character, as far as his temperament, as they say, do you think, I mean, he was accused of being unhinged by Jeb Bush. When you look at the way he changes his mind from one day to the next, is this a person who could conceivably be president of the United States?
This is another one of those things. This is media stuff. Was Berlusconi any less unhinged? And by the way, what about Jeb's brother? Here's a guy who got us involved in two unnecessary wars, in Iraq and in Afghanistan, both of which turned into disasters, whose policies, deregulatory policies, basically produced the collapse of 2007-2008, who lied like a rug. He lied like a rug. Well, you know what I mean. He lied consistently with regard to everything from the weapons of mass destruction to the different reasons why an invasion should take place. But he, of course, according to Jeb, he's totally competent to be president. I mean, it's appalling. The issue isn't the temperament of of Trump any more than the issue is the temperament of Berlusconi. The issue is, what is the man putting forward? And it seems to me what he's putting forward is an attack on the system without positive policies. That's what this is about, in my view anyway. And this is a traditional, either fascist or neo-fascist position. So is, or perspective. And this is also with regard to his temperament. His temperament, what to me is most interesting about it, is that it's there to build himself up. It's egoism. It's not that he's a loon, although he may be a loon too. But there are many stories with regard to Hitler, who was known for his temper tantrums. And in one case, he had, I think it may have been during the Czechoslovakia crisis, where he had Neville Chamberlain, and he was in a room, and he threw one of these enormous temper tantrums, walked out the door, slammed the door, ran into his secretary, and he said, do you think you could get me a cup of tea?
Oh, my God.
And, you know, half of this stuff was pre-planned. And if Trump is so stupid, I mean, he's got a point. And if he's so temperamentally unfit, how did he get all these votes to begin with? Plus, if we're talking about, again, with the uniqueness, you know, already we've forgotten about Ben Carson. We've forgotten about Ted Cruz. We've forgotten about this group of pygmies who were involved in the Republican campaign, whose policies were basically indistinguishable, with one or two exceptions, from those of Trump. It's what's what is frightening to everyone is the fact that he won. And instead of asking why it is that this entire right-wing clique has basically the same perspective, and blaming trying to analyze what is it that brought this about, you're going to be driven back to the conservative establishment and its failings. This way, oh, he's just bamboozled everyone. This is what people say about Hitler. This is what they've said about Berlusconi. This is what they've said about Mussolini. I mean, give it a rest, you know? And I think let's start speaking about the conditions that made for this person. Not in the abstract, but quite concretely. And as you reap, so you sow. And I think that's a phrase that could go back to Mitch McConnell and the boys.
So I'm going to respond to that and just say that I think it is a phenomenon that the country has been moving to the right, I would say, over the past, not just the past three decades, but even going further back. In 1934, there was this American Liberty League that was founded by the DuPonts. And I know something about this too, because my grandfather on my father's side, his cousin married the daughter of Irene DuPont, who was the main muscle behind the American Liberty League. Now, we're not close, but anyway, the story is that during the New Deal, you know, most of the country went along with that. You know, the people are starving, people are out of work, you got to do something about it. There was a small cabal of wealthy businessmen who said, no, we're not going to go with that. In fact, we would like FDR to be defeated. Mm-hmm. And they created this organization, this American Liberty League, to promulgate these ideology, far right wing, conservative, free market ideology. You know, you're out of work, so it's your fault. There must be something wrong with you. You're not one of God's chosen. And you could talk about Ayn Rand, you know, and her philosophy. So that was just the beginning. Then after that, you had the Mount Pelerin Society. You had the FEE, Foundation for Economic Education, which is still functioning up in White Plains, putting out these tracts, putting out these pamphlets, John Birch Society, we go on and on. Ronald Reagan becomes the golden boy, mm-hmm. because when he is, after his acting career was over, and he tried to make a go at it in Las Vegas with a one-man show, which didn't pan out, he needed a job. And so he got a job with General Electric as a spokesperson, and he went from plant to plant. He was only supposed to talk about washing machines and dryers, mm-hmm. but it turns out that this guy, Lemuel Bulwar, who was vice president, I think, of labor issues, and hated labor, and actually would try to destroy the labor movement, he recruited Ronald Reagan as an acolyte and began to give him pamphlets to read, books to read. And because Reagan was afraid to fly, he would take the train around to these GE plants. He would read all this stuff on the train. And so he got indoctrinated. Reagan went from being a New Deal Democrat, he campaigned for Harry Truman in 1948, to being a Republican. So, but then all of that, Reagan gets elected in 1980, the country continues to move to the right, and I think what we're seeing is a kind of end game of that, maybe, possibly, with the Republican Party maybe falling apart. Do you think Trump is destroying the Republican Party?
I think this all depends, that depends what you mean. Will the Republican Party remain? Yeah, I think so. What you said is, of course, right on target. I would just supplement that, though, in one way. When you think of right-wing movements, these are mass movements. These aren't something that is simply, paid for AstroTurf organizations, which was the claim about the Tea Party. I don't think it works like that. If you look back to the beginning of the, virtually to the beginning of the country, you think of the Know-Nothings. You think of the after the Civil War, the Ku Klux Klan. The Ku Klux Klan had millions of members. You go forward to the America Firsters and the anti-Roosevelt people, and the early fascist and neo-fascist groups, even people like Huey Long. And then you go forward to McCarthyism, another mass movement. This wasn't just an elite. I think there were 100,000 people in the country dismissed. Then you go forward again, and you wind up with the moral majority, the moral majority, whatever the majority is. There's a reason why that term is used all the time. And the reason is because these are mass movements. Now, if they've existed throughout American history, why should it be that this is the end? In other words, you haven't gotten rid of the mass movement, even if there's failure. What you've gotten rid of is this particular expression of the mass movement. And so I think this will, this is not going to go away, just like the neoconservatism in foreign policy has not gone away. A greater failure is difficult to imagine than the neoconservative foreign policy outlook. If you think back to the Bush years, anyone who traveled knew that America was considered a laughingstock because of Bush and the boys and Rumsfeld and so on. Then there was Iraq. There was Afghanistan. These were disastrous policy decisions. Have you yourself brought up Jeb Bush as someone who's, supposedly rational vis-a-vis Donald Trump? What about if we look at it this way, in a slightly different way? Liberals like to say that what defines America is a commitment to what Arthur Schlesinger called the vital center. To a certain extent, with regard to political parties and political elites, there's a certain truth to that, that America's driven to American political elites and parties are driven to the center, most of them. But that's not true with regard to mass social movements. Social movements have been extremist since the country was founded. But we don't look at those. And that's, this is a fault of education, which I think is very serious. Very serious. This desire for us to be unique, for this candidate or that candidate to be unique. And precisely because he's unique, we don't have to take any responsibility for, we on the left, for allowing this to come about because he caught us by surprise. I think that's nonsense. And I think that's nonsense with regard to the Brexit also. If I can mention.
Please.
Here for years, decades, there's been a bubbling, a simmering right-wing movement in Europe. It's sprouted up in different places at different times. In Greece, with the New Dawn, in Hungary with Jobbik, in France with Le Pen, Marine Le Pen and her father, and you ask yourself, what is it that gives this xenophobic, racist set of groups its dynamism? Is it anything real or isn't it? One thing that's real is that the European Union is basically defined by bureaucrats, technocrats. They're concerned about introducing monetary policies that basically aided the elites. The euro has been a disaster. And they've essentially been concerned with fundamentally bureaucratic concerns other than, or maybe including, the elimination of internal borders. But there's no one, there's been no policy that's worth talking about that would build the cultural commitments to Europe rather than to the old nationalisms and the like. There's simply been no counterweight. Anyone you talk to, the argument is, well, Europe is, the European Union is alienated from everyday people. It's just another bureaucratic layer. It works in the interests of elites. And that's true. Or at least I think it's true. Were these issues that could have been dealt with? Absolutely. But the technocrat is generally a wise guy. And in a certain we know what's going on, not like these idiots out there. And this, of course, is fodder for the resentment of those people who feel themselves excluded from society, who are scared of modernity, who fear a multicultural universe, who are disgusted with globalization, and so on. This was resistible. It wasn't just inevitable. And of course, once one makes it inevitable, one is easily able to slide out of any responsibility. And I think that has a lot to do with this. And again, the mainstream media has been appalling in its unwillingness to raise these kind of issues, at least from what I can see.
Well, you know, this television show that you're watching, people, is my attempt to break away from the bureaucracy of universities, okay? I went to a program to learn how to become an English teacher at NYU in the mid-1990s. It was a program in English education that was actually founded by a woman named Louise Rosenblatt in 1948, who's one of the leading thinkers in the field of literary studies, in the field of English education. I got the best ideas you could imagine in terms of teaching and how to construct classrooms that are social justice oriented, that are democratic, that are aesthetic, that have using the best ideas. But they told us this, that when you go out to teach, you're going to probably know more than your boss. Now, I found this to be the true. In places that I've taught, implementing pedagogy that's effective, that works, that the students enjoy it, getting students who have hated to read and write to love reading and writing, to dialogue, to discuss, to create this almost utopian classroom environment, the more the students love it, the more my colleagues hate me. The more the administrators tell me, oh, you can't do that. You have to use a textbook. Well, wait a minute. The leaders in the field tell me don't use a textbook. The best minds say you bring in excerpts. You show films. You have dialogue. You talk about real issues. So I'm dealing with bureaucrats all the time, and I understand the frustration with that. And Trump, I think, is speaking to that to a certain extent. Yeah. He's channeling. This is a real guy. This is a real person. He's not a robot. He's not an automaton. And okay, so maybe I don't agree with all his policies. You know, this one I don't like him on immigration. Maybe he'll keep us safe. Maybe he'll do this. But at least he's talking like a person that you can trust him. And I think that's one reason that, and Bernie too. I saw Bernie at town hall. Last speech he made about 2 weeks ago at town hall, I was there, Bernie Sanders. I love him. I mean, he says the same thing over and over again, but he's talking from his conscience and he's saying things that are real. Hillary seems to talk in a monotone way that you don't trust it. Like, she's part of the system, part of the status quo, part of the corruption. Although I'm sure she's got qualities that are good too, okay? If you took the best qualities of Hillary and Bernie and Trump and combined them, maybe you would have a better candidate. Or maybe we need to get beyond the party structure we have now, Stephen. I want to get into something more visionary here. This could be a third party moment. This could be a bull moose moment in this country right now. I'm just putting it out there, because you got disaffected Bernie people who are not going to vote for Hillary, okay? You got Green Party people. You got Republicans who agree with Trump to a point but think he's too crazy to be president. And all these folks got together, you might have a party.
Yeah, I think we may look at this a little different, bit differently. To me, what Bernie Sanders comes out of is a particular tradition. It's the tradition of Norman Thomas. It's the tradition of Michael Harrington, the late Michael Harrington, one of the founders of Democratic Socialists of America, and who wrote The Other America, 10 million people living in poverty, I think it was in 1960. What Michael Harrington argued was, and what Thomas argued, and actually even what Earl Browder argued, the old communist leader, was we're just not strong enough, and we're not going to become strong enough. What we can do, and what we should do, is serve as gadflies within the Democratic Party. In other words, always try and push it to the left. Isn't that what Bernie did? You know? And isn't that what the Tea Party did with enormous success? The structure of the American party system militates unbelievably against third parties. It makes it almost impossible. This is why I always teach, even in introductory courses, The Federalist Papers by James Madison and Alexander Hamilton and John Jay. And they make clear the way the structure works. And I don't think it's changed very much. There's the central structural concern was to undermine the possibility for them, the poor, the great beast, as they were called, to organize in their own behalf. And we may not have had an Aristotle or a Hegel or a Marx, but we had these guys in the newspapers setting up this kind of system, and this is why the elites today in Europe look at the United States so positively. It's not because of in my opinion anyway, it's not because of the melting pot or this kind of thing. No, it's not because of the individual's ability to move forward. No, it's that the United States has been able to constrain and undermine the possibility of developing a labor party. I mean, it's just, in my opinion, that's, if there's something about American exceptionalism, that's it. Wow. Yeah. Now, just to take it a step further, I think it's very important to recognize that, again, this is a media thing. Well, we have this exchange of people between Trump and Bernie. Why? Because both are into positive social policies. This, to me, is completely the wrong way to look at this. Every fascist movement that I know of, a neo-fascist movement, has pushed progressive social policies. The Nazis were as Keynesian as the Social Democrats, only in different ways. In somewhat different ways. Where the real difference comes about is the part that's always played down. What is that? The politics. Bernie Sanders is a man of great integrity. He's spoken about the need for class solidarity, not make America great again, this kind of xenophobia, but a kind of class solidarity that speaks to the lowly and the insulted, as the Bible calls them, the disenfranchised and the exploited. His concern is with moving beyond identity politics. I mean, it's quite obvious. His concern is with developing a new multilateral position on foreign policy, on embracing climate change and the environment. We could go down the list here endlessly. This is different than Trump.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's, and in the principles it puts forward, it's also different than Hillary, who inherited from her husband, or worked out with her husband, what was called triangulation. In other words, we take a conservative position, let's say Trump, we take a Bernie position, which is leftist, and we position ourselves, we the Hillary people, just a bit to the left of the conservative position, but just a bit to the right of the Bernie position. That seems to me a very different approach towards politics than either of them has. And Hillary, I mean, to me, there's no class argument going on here. There's, and I think that the, if I can put it this way, the older, that black vote that she gets is from older blacks, not from young people. What she's received is the support for a black establishment, a political establishment, which is as corrupt as any other establishment. I mean, why can't a black political leader in this country be corrupt?
Right.
You know, that happens too.
Yeah.
No, I think there's a real qualitative difference between these candidates, for better or worse. And one has to work with that.
Yeah. Well, the, the Black Lives Matter people with Cornel West, who's part of that. They're not.
By the way, of course, was a major supporter. He was a major supporter of Bernie Sanders.
Correct. So they are not exactly on Hillary's bandwagon, as far as I see. Now, if you could see, I got my button on here, Stephen. This is my button when I ran for president in 2012. Okay, and it says here, vote for a 25-hour work week. That was the central plank of my candidacy. Now, I want you to know that I didn't get any votes because I didn't have any super.
You were kept out of it.
I was kept. They didn't give me any. Not one super PAC dollar. I didn't even get mediocre PACs. Forget about super PAC. Mediocre PACs stayed away from me. Okay, but anyway. That kept me sane, you know, by doing something, trying something, getting out there. And this idea of a shorter work week, okay, and a guaranteed income for everybody. What if everybody got a check? This is something that even Nixon was considering this. You know, this is not far radical lefty stuff. The idea that there's not enough jobs to go around, so we have to take care of people, you know. What if, and I think this could also be related to the breakdown in our education, that people just don't have time to read. Look at all the beautiful books on the shelf here. Who has time to read books? And if we have an education system that's dumbing down and that's training people for jobs instead of educating for critical thinking, how do you have a population of citizens who can be trusted to vote if they don't even know what's going on? So I think we really need is more of what we're doing now, conversation, dialogue, small groups getting together. I'm actually working with Richard Dreyfuss now, who the actor who has a civics project, and it's a very commendable idea to get citizens together talking about basic civics and basic politics 101 and to teach it in schools and out of schools, and certainly, you know, you're invited to be part of the project. I brought you in. You had a wonderful conversation with Richard the other day, which was great. I know you're busy, you know, around the world and all your stuff. But I think there's something to that. I think there's something to the fact that we really need to learn stuff and educate ourselves. You, Stephen, have wrote this wonderful book on critical theory, and you're one of these people who can actually translate some of these ideas that are very intellectual in a down-to-earth way that everyday people can understand. You've been sort of my tutor here to, you know, as we gather and we have these discussions and you give me books. I actually met one of your students also, Michael Thompson, at the Eric Fromm conference earlier this year, which you invited me to. That was great. A whole conference on the ideas of Eric Fromm, who wrote this book called The Sane Society, that said, you know, this society is crazy. You know, it's absolutely nuts. And the title of that conference was The Insane Society. In was in parentheses, Remembering Eric Fromm and the Frankfurt School. What can we learn from those guys? What can we learn from that tradition that we could bring it to our public now? You very, very rarely do you see intellectuals like yourself on television. Although, I'm going to give high praise to David Letterman, because toward the end of his run with his Tonight Show, with his Late Show, he featured Cornel West on television. So, do you think there could be an opening now in terms of, because the media is also a form of education. People learn from watching television shows as much as they learn from taking classes in schools. Do you think that America is ready for these more substantive, deeper intellectual concepts like critical thinking, critical theory?
I have to say, I think America has always been ready. I've never simply bought the idea that people don't read because they don't have time. I mean, it's not like that generation which grew up in the Depression, you know, is just twiddling its thumbs and, out there. No, I think we have new possibilities with the internet, with the web, which are remarkable. They open real possibilities to learn things, to make the world bigger for everyone. The issue is there a push to have this used in that way? Or is there a push to have the internet and and so on pushed in order to play video games, or to go into the the esoteric small issues that seem to obsess the internet? So I think that's, as educators, that's what we have to do. We have to really begin to talk about why people should learn and how to use the new technology to learn better. That's my view. The rest, I forgot what I was going to say. What was it you mentioned before? With regard to, I know, the 25-hour week.
Yes, my campaign.
Yes, it shows the remarkable visionary quality of your enterprise. Exactly.
Thank you. I got one vote. Okay.
And of course the guaranteed income. You know, I think I even said to you earlier, my interest has always been with the labor movement and its different forms. And the one thing, no matter where you look, socialists, anarchists, communists, as protest movements, what united all of them was the desire for a shorter work week. Yeah? Why? Because most work is just disgusting. I mean, everybody knows that. Is it necessary? Is the worst kind of work necessary? Obviously not. I think you're quite right with this. I also think you're right with regard to this not simply being utopian, especially the idea of a guaranteed income. Part of the entire purpose of the welfare state, I mean, it's not simply that elites are giving this away out of the goodness of their hearts. There's a desire to build demand for products that are produced. The problem with capitalism has never been supply or production. It's always been demand and consumption, because people don't have any money. This would perhaps give them some money and perhaps open people, if the education's there, to become better citizens, to participate, to read things, to travel. You know, hardly anybody in the United States travels. It's very weird. I read somewhere that only 10% of Americans actually travel outside their state. Now, I don't know if I could be wrong on this. I could have the numbers wrong. But it was some very low number. That's also true with regard to reading, as you know. By the way, part of the reason, I think, I'm sure you're a great teacher. And I'm sure also that it wasn't just the bureaucratic bean counters. Think about how we talk about bureaucrats, by the way. Highly specialized, highly formula-driven, highly efficiency-obsessed bean counters. Right. In German, you have a term for what's called a disciplinary idiot. I like that.
I like it.
Yeah. Perhaps this is a way to not only make life better for people economically, but to build the franchise politically. It's possible. Usually, not always, but usually you have progressive politics fundamentally connected with progressive economics. It's not the other... it's not the case the other way around. You can have progressive politics, progressive economics linked to reactionary politics much more often. Wow. It's interesting, right?
Well, I'm in the process of actually taking my teaching outside of classrooms, right? Traditional hierarchical institutions and universities. And the new class I'm teaching is actually on big dream stories, something I've identified, which is that if you have a big dream, whatever it is, if it's a personal dream or it could be a dream for a, you know, world peace, very often there are stories around that dream. So last month, I gave a seminar called The Magic and Power of Big Dream Stories, The Magic and Power of Big Dream Stories at the Symposia Bookstore in Hoboken. That we had about 8 people who showed up, which is okay in the beginning when you start something new. And it's a little bookstore, so it, you know, it was sitting in a circle and sharing our dreams and our stories around our dreams. And this comes from my own pedagogy, my thinking about education, in particular building on the work of Jerome Bruner, who died about a month ago. He was 100 years old, Jerome Bruner. Yeah, he actually discovered that people think in terms of stories. So stories are not just some, you know, fluffy thing that you're just telling stories. No, stories are very powerful. There's a cognitive aspect to storytelling. And I think people with big dreams also have to have space to keep those dreams alive. Very often in my classroom teaching in a college, I'll ask my students what their big dreams are, and you want to know something? Zilch. Very few people even have a big dream anymore. So, and I don't think universities are encouraging that either. I think universities now have pretty much become diploma mills, run by corporations, training people for work. Obviously, you have better universities here and there, and Rutgers has you, and you know, you have good departments and this and that. So that's really where I'm heading. And next week, I'll be teaching again at the Symposium Bookstore, and I changed the title to Big Dream Story Circle. Big Dream Story Circle. So it's this idea of a circle of people having a dialogue and sharing their dreams and, you know, inspiring each other. And
you know, I think that's really interesting. My own view on this is, as you know, you asked about Fromm and the Frankfurt School. I studied with Ernst Bloch, who is the great philosopher of utopia. And Bloch always said that what's involved here is a basic lack of imagination. I tried this once, he's long dead, but I tried this once because he sort of mentioned it to me. I asked my class, an intro class, to give me a short paragraph on what their view of utopia is. And what was amazing, it's exactly the way you said, what's amazing is all they came up with was stuff that you could have right now.
Imagination was not there.
Exactly. And we don't push that enough. I think you're absolutely right with that. This great slogan in the 60s was power to the imagination. I think that's part of what they had in mind. That's how you get the new.
Wow. And I also want to give a shout out to Warren Beatty, the great actor who is really one of my heroes, in particular because of 2 movies that he made, Reds and Bullworth. I think Bullworth is one of the most forward-thinking, visionary movies of our time, you know, in terms of politics. I mean, it's a film that mentions socialism in a positive light. There's that scene where he's given a speech, you know, Bullworth, and he starts rapping, you know, and he says to Paul Sorvino, who plays the insurance company, you know, president, and he goes, "Let me hear you say that dirty word, socialism, socialism. When have you heard the word socialism uttered in a mainstream American movie ever?" And I think that's a great example of what could be done with culture. Also, in Bullworth, there's a cameo by the great Amiri Baraka, who has a small but very significant role in that movie. And he says, "You got to sing, fool," to Booth, "and the spirit will not descend without song." Right? Amiri Baraka, the great poet and activist whose son is now the mayor of Newark, New Jersey. So we do have to remember our great leaders who came before us, too, and our ancestors, and people like Ernst Bloch, you know, that people are not learning this stuff. Which is why I really think that there is a big problem in our educational system, and it's got to be radically restructured and reimagined. And we're trying to do that with this program, with our this television show that you're watching. Really is a form of education. People could watch this and learn that there is a Stephen Eric Bronner, a political scientist who has written a dozen books, and they could really start to fashion their own curriculum and be reading your work and be, you know, looking at your other YouTubes and going to your lectures. And I'm also working now on a play, a one-man show, which is titled How to Be an Actor in Your Own Life, which has to do with agency and having a sense of agency. And what agency means, for those who don't know, and it's a word from education philosophy that ought to be more well known, it means to be able to move through the world, to be able to make choices and act on them, to not be stuck and submerged. Like so many people, Claudia and I live in Hoboken, and you see the masses getting off the train at 7, 8 o'clock at night, working longer and longer hours with the iPhones coming out of the ears. What kind of imagination, if you're working a job, that so much of it is dummy work, I think. So much of it is just paper shuffling back and forth. We could very easily have that shorter work week. But as you notice, that people now are majoring in business and marketing, and they're not studying philosophy. You studied philosophy. You studied in Germany. You studied at UC Berkeley, one of the great colleges of our country. So what are your thoughts about that?
Well, yeah, that's certainly true. The social sciences and especially the humanities are being undercut. There's the money that's around for educational development is for online courses. Some of these online courses, you have 4,000 or 5,000 people. I mean, these are big courses and they're real cash cows. At some level, though, I do think there's an individual responsibility. It's almost a question of dignity to find out what's happening to you. And as important as it is for educators to attack, you know, these ideas of street wisdom and everyday, the non-intellectual knowledge, it's also up to young people to make the decision that they're not going to simply be fooled. They're going to learn. I've spent much time recently thinking about the will to know. And I think it's very hard to have an ethical standpoint without having the will to know. The two are connected.
And sometimes, though, you get so submerged that you don't even know what you're thinking and feeling. And I think that's when psychoanalysis can be very, very helpful. And it's so interesting because we are located right here in Fort Lee, New Jersey, a block away from where my first great psychoanalyst, Stephen, his name was Stephen. Stephen Knobloch was his name. Was a great man, and he really liberated me to think and to feel and to really think about who I was and what I wanted to do with my life. And it was because of that analysis and that work that I became an English major at Fordham University, that I then went on to NYU for a master's in education. I became a professor and a writer and a thinker and a talk show host. All began in psychoanalysis. So I think I always like to put a plug in for psychoanalysis. Maybe Donald Trump could get on the couch immediately, if not sooner, you know. But I wanted to also throw in, we only have a few minutes left. Claudia says 3 minutes left. I'm reading Don Quixote now for the first time. I think it's an amazing book. It's a very long book, but it's about imagination, and it's about being unpredictable and going for your dreams, and there's a lot to that. What about your reading habits? What are you reading now? I mean, when intellectuals, when you talk to each other, you want to know what you're reading, what's happening in your own reading life.
I've been reading some. I've been reading novels basically lately. I've read Baudelaire's Dream and The Marriage of Cadmus and Harmony by Roberto Colasso, which is was just a magnificent author. Very difficult, but really a magnificent author. And then I finished a while ago the terrific book called Life and Fate by Vasily Grossman, which is sort of like War and Peace under Stalin, if that makes sense. An extraordinary, extraordinary character. And then I've been reading a bit about the history of the Middle East. I always like to do that. And I've also read off and on. I've been reading some stuff on the 30 Years' War, for the simple reason I find it very similar to I find it as illuminating what religious intolerance can do, and it's very apt for our time.
And we also have to, we have to say goodbye. We are out of time, Claudia says. My goodness. What a pleasure, Stephen. Thank you so much for inviting us into your lovely Fort Lee home and this great intellectual discourse. We'll go on, and thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you. I appreciate it very much.